pleasure to introduce this morning's speaker, Woody Ulfer, who is the Advocacy Director at the New York Civil Liberties Union. Mr. Ulfer is responsible for overseeing the work of the NYCLU to influence public policy in the areas of immigration, education, and national security. He is an adjunct professor at New York Law School, where he teaches a course on public policy. He's a frequent commentator on civil liberties issues on local and national media, including Associated Press, NPR, The Nation, The New York Times, and New York One. He's a graduate of Fordham University Law School, where he was a Stein Scholar in Public Interest Law and Ethics. I think you're in the right place. His talk today, I'll be sharing some of his recent work examining racial profiling post-9/11.
Everyone hear me? Great. What a great way to start a Sunday. I think I'm going to have you play for me every Sunday. As Monica mentioned, my name is Woody Ulfer, and I'm with the New York Civil Liberties Union. And not only am I thankful to the New York Society of Ethical Culture for inviting me here today, but I'm also thankful to the New York Society for Ethical Culture for helping create the American Civil Liberties Union. As any students of history know, the Ethical Cultural Society was a key reason that the ACLU even exists today, and we are allies on many, many different issues. For those of you who are not familiar with the New York Civil Liberties Union, let me just quickly give you a bit of a context for it. Many people think of us as a New York City organization, but we are actually a statewide organization, and the New York Civil Liberties Union has 8 offices across New York State that many people aren't aware of. We have offices in Buffalo, in Rochester, in Syracuse, Albany, White Plains, here in New York City, and two on Long Island. And it's part of the ACLU model, which is to be all over the country and to have offices all over the nation. We're a local organization, we're a statewide organization, we're a national organization. I like to say that it's us and the Catholic Church who have the most kind of reach. And we work on a whole host of issues. It's one of the most exciting things and one of the most daunting things of working at the New York Civil Liberties Union. We cover the full spectrum of our what we believe are fundamental human rights for all people. And whether it's the First Amendment to the 14th Amendment, we cover the gamut of issues. But today I'm going to speak about a very specific issue and one that I care very deeply about. And for the New York Civil Liberties Union, we have identified this as a major priority for us in 2012 and for many years to come, and it has been for many years. And that is the countering the three faces of profiling in the post-9/11 era, because there are really three faces of it, and each one is unique. So I will begin by sharing three stories, which I think is the best way to explain what it is that we're concerned about. So one evening in August of 2006, Nicholas Hurd was celebrating his 18th birthday with his cousin and a friend. He was staying at his sister's house on 96th Street in Amsterdam, so not too far from here, and decided to walk to a nearby restaurant to get some burgers. It's his birthday. The restaurant was closed, so Nicholas and his friend and cousin decided to sit on the benches in the median strip that runs along Broadway. They were talking, watching the night go by, enjoying the evening when suddenly, out of nowhere, NYPD squad cars surrounded them. A policeman yelled from the window, "Get on the ground!" Nicholas, who's African-American, was stunned and scared. He got on the ground, and a police officer pointed a gun at him. He couldn't see what was happening, but he could feel the policeman's hand reach inside his pockets. The police officer looked through the wallet that he had just taken out and found the ID that Nicholas was carrying. He said, "Happy birthday," in a sarcastic manner. The police officer then questioned Nicholas's cousin and friend, asked what they were doing, and then said goodnight and left them on the sidewalk. No charges and no arrests were made. 2 years later, NYPD officers stopped and frisked Nicholas again. Again, they went through his wallet, and again, they didn't let him go. And 2 years again after that, it happened a third time. He was stopped, frisked, searched, ID'd, and let go. Second story. Sasan Taba and Hassan Shibli live in Buffalo, New York. Sasan works as a clinical instructor at the SUNY Buffalo Dental School. Hassan, at the time when this happened, was an 18-year-old political science student at SUNY Buffalo. Sasan and Hassan, along with many others, attended the Reviving the Islamic Conference Spirit in Toronto, Canada, in December of 2004. Sasan and Hassan are both Muslim, and the Reviving the Islamic Spirit Conference is a time for them to meet other like-minded Muslims and learn more about their faith and celebrate it. The conference is an annual event that draws thousands of people, including elected officials from Canada. The mayor of Toronto was actually at this one particular conference, and even law enforcement representatives. On their way home from the conference, they arrived at the border, so from Toronto to Buffalo, after midnight, it was December 27th. With Sasan, with both Sasan and her daughter wear a hijab, as their custom dictates, and both are U.S. citizens. So when they crossed the border, they didn't think they would have any problems, and both presented their United States passport, which an agent asked for. The agent then asked why they were in Canada, and Hassan replied that the family had attended the Reviving the Islamic Spirit Conference. The agent told them that they all had been selected for, quote, a random inspection, and ordered them to park their car and wait in a nearby building. Upon entering the building, the family was shocked to see several other Muslim families who had attended the conference with them, including friends who had left Toronto hours before them. They saw an elderly couple with their two young children sleeping in their arms, several babies, and a pregnant woman who looked very pale and had swollen eyes. The Taba family also saw several families who attend their local mosque in Buffalo, New York. After the family waited anxiously for several hours, agents ordered the family to complete some forms. They directed Hassan to an isolated room with two armed guards who ordered Hassan to empty out his pockets. The agents then turned Hassan to face the wall and kicked his legs open so forcefully that Hassan almost fell to the ground. The agents then administered a pat-down search. After the degrading search, agents then took Hassan to be fingerprinted and photographed. He protested that he was not a criminal and did not want to be fingerprinted or photographed, but the agents ordered Hassan to cooperate and forcefully took Hassan's hand for a digital scan of his fingerprints. Agents then ordered Sasan, his mother, to provide her fingerprints. Sasan peacefully refused, stating that she wanted to leave this detention center and just go home. She said that she did not want to be fingerprinted unless the agents had some reason to suspect her of a crime. An agent said that if she tried to leave, though, the agent would track her down and she would be placed in a detention cell. Afraid that the agents would hurt her family, Sasan agreed to follow the agents into a separate room to be fingerprinted. Sasan's youngest daughter was crying and would not let go of her mother, and Sasan cried as well as agents separately forced her from her daughter to be fingerprinted. At approximately 5:30 in the morning, after detaining them for 3.5 hours, border agents then released Sasan, Hassan, and their family. They were not providing an explanation. We, the New York Civil Liberties Union, sued on their behalf, and we learned that the government was worried the terrorists may attend the conference, and so they wanted to fingerprint and photograph every person coming back from this conference, including United States citizens. And of course, they did not find any terrorists. Third story. In 2009, a United States citizen who was born in Mexico was stopped in his car by Border Patrol agents. This was in Oswego County between Rochester and Syracuse, north of here. And his wife and his children were in the car with him. The Border Patrol agents demanded to see his driver's license. The man, who has been a United States citizen for 12 years, was originally born in Mexico, produced his New York State driver's license. And for those of you who don't know, in New York State, you have to be a lawful immigrant or a United States citizen to even get a driver's license. So in effect, it is an immigration document. But the Border Patrol agents refused to believe that this driver's license was real and accused him of being in the United States illegally. He explained politely that he was a United States citizen, a naturalized citizen, and has been living in the U.S. since 1988. But the Border Patrol agents refused to believe him. They ordered him to get out of the car. When he got out of the car, they then turned him around and handcuffed him. His family members, who were still in the car, pleaded for the Border Patrol agents not to arrest him and said that they could offer proof of his citizenship. The Border Patrol agents then said, "I don't care what you guys have to say, he's going to the station, he's illegal." They then took the man to the Border Patrol station where he was interrogated, fingerprinted, and photographed. After hours of detention, his wife arrived with a copy of her husband's U.S. passport and naturalization certificate. He was released without charges. When he asked, "Why did you arrest me?" all they could say is, "We can't tell you." And they didn't even apologize. So unfortunately, these three stories are not unique. They represent the experiences of millions of Americans. Profiling by the government, and in particularly by law enforcement, has long been a problem in the United States. But in the post-9/11 era, it has taken on greater magnitude. This is true both in law enforcement practices that are being undertaken in the name of national security, such as counterterrorism investigations and crackdown on immigration, and it is also true in more traditional law enforcement. But the same philosophy drives all three forms of profiling. A belief that race, a belief that ethnicity, a belief that religion should be a significant factor in law enforcement activities. In the counterterrorism context, it is being Muslim. In the immigration context, it is being Latino. In the street policing context, it is being Black or Brown. So for example, under the administration of Mayor Bloomberg and Police Commissioner Ray Kelly, who took office right after 9/11, the NYPD has engaged in the disturbing pattern of stopping and frisking hundreds of thousands of New Yorkers like Nicholas Hurd on an annual basis, most of whom are Black or Latino, and most of whom have done absolutely nothing wrong. In 2002, the year that Mayor Bloomberg and Ray Kelly took office, the NYPD made about 97,000 stops. By 2011, this had increased to 684,000 stops, an increase of more than 600%. On their way to school, work, home, or just spending time in their neighborhood, Black and Latino New Yorkers have been stopped on the street, have been questioned about their activities, and have been searched for weapons or contraband. Yet this practice is ineffective and this practice is wrong. How is it ineffective? The NYPD's practice of stop and frisk does not detect crime. Year after year, nearly 90% of individual stops are absolutely innocent and are neither arrested nor issued a summons. Yet they are stopped on the street, humiliated before their friends and family, and treated like criminals. And it's ineffective in getting weapons off the street, which is one of the main arguments for the practice. And only around 1% of the stops are any weapons retrieved, and it really, weapons is a very subjective question. So for example, things like a box cutter knife could be considered a weapon. It is also ineffective because it alienates entire communities. As a consequence of this practice, entire communities are increasingly loath to report crime and are less willing to cooperate with police. Young people are particularly vulnerable to this harmful practice, and they develop distrust of police that lasts a lifetime. And it is also discriminatory and unethical. This practice is being administered in a manner that targets Black and Latino men. Black and Latino residents comprise about 53% of New York City's population, yet they make up about 83% of all stops. And the police use physical force more often on Black and Latino people during stops than on non-Black or Latino people. And by the way, it's not just about race. About half of all stops are people ages 14 to 24, and more than 90% are male. And what's most frustrating, it seems like as the criticism of this practice has increased, and many of you probably read about the stop and frisk phenomenon this week in the papers and on TV since we released new data on the practice from 2011. And it seems as the criticism has increased, the NYPD's response has been to rely on this practice even more. But also under the Bloomberg and Kelly administration, the Muslim community in New York City has been subject to widespread surveillance of their everyday activities. In August of 2011, the Associated Press issued a story based on a months-long investigation that confirmed many of the fears that many of us had about profiling and NYPD intelligence gathering. According to the series of reports, NYPD has been dispatching quote-unquote rakers, which is a term used to rake the coals looking for hotspots, into the Muslim community to monitor daily life in bookstores and mosques and cafes and in nightclubs. And as we learned today in an Associated Press press article that was released today, they've also been moderating Muslims in Muslim student associations, which are student clubs in colleges and high schools. Undercover officers hang out in hookah bars, bookstores, and cafes to observe the community. They go to internet cafes and look at the browsing history on a computer to decide whether the cafe should be deemed a hotspot. They go to bookstores, and if a customer looked at controversial literature, the undercover officer would chat with the store owner to get more information and potentially subject the bookstore customer to additional scrutiny. The NYPD has also been using informants, known as quote-unquote mosque crawlers, to monitor religious services, even when there's no evidence of any wrongdoing whatsoever. In fact, the NYPD produced a report at every mosque within 100 miles of New York City. They sent police officers to Pakistani neighborhoods, like in the Midwood section of Brooklyn. And according to the AP report, the officers were instructed to look for any reason to stop cars, such as speeding or broken taillight or not signaling when turning, any reason to stop cars. This in turn would give the NYPD an excuse to search the NCIC database, which is a criminal database, and look for suspicious behavior and have to pull them over the car. The NYPD denies that it surveils Muslim neighborhoods without following leads, yet it's becoming apparent that this is not the case, and in fact they are. And in fact, this is part of a pattern of post-9/11 activities by government. Since September 11, 2001, and in the name of national security, thousands of Arabs, Muslims, and South Asians have been detained, interrogated, or deported based solely or primarily on their ethnicity or religion. And the third story was about immigration. And when it comes to immigration policies, this is actually where Mayor Bloomberg and Commissioner Kelly should be commended. They have done extraordinary work, actually, to be leaders in the nation about the importance of local government not engaging in federal immigration enforcement. Almost immediately after Mayor Bloomberg took office, he issued Executive Order 41, which essentially created a don't ask, don't tell policy in New York City, where government agents are prohibited from asking about a person's immigration status unless it's a qualification for the benefits, and are also prohibited from informing the federal government about undocumented immigrants, again, with exceptions. And we don't like some of the exceptions, but it's a pretty good policy. But outside of New York City, in upstate New York and nationally, profiling as part of immigration enforcement is a major problem. So for example, and I'm not sure, I don't think a lot of New York City residents are aware of this, but Latino New Yorkers really cannot travel on public transportation upstate, particularly along the northern border with Canada, without worrying about being stopped or detained. Border Patrol agents have been boarding Amtrak trains and in Greyhound buses that never cross the border. These are domestic trains and buses that go from New York City to Detroit, or New York City to Buffalo, or Syracuse to Chicago. They board Amtrak trains and buses and ask everyone on board for their ID and their proof of immigration status. If you cannot produce your proof, or if an agent does not believe the authenticity of your license, like in the example that I provided you earlier, you get pulled off the train or the bus and subject to detention, potentially also detention thousands of miles away from your home, since it's an immigration detention system. A couple of months ago, we released a report about this practice, and we found that the people who are being picked up on trains and buses in upstate New York, and particularly in the Rochester area, are people who have lived in the United States for a very long time, are people that have created roots in the United States, that have families, that may have children who are United States citizens, and not people who are sneaking through the border, which is traditionally what Border Patrol agents focused on. But also, we found that the people who are being arrested are mostly Latin American men, and individuals, quote-unquote, with a medium or black complexion, according to the data that we got through a FOIL request. 73% of arrestees came from Latin America, and of the 2,776 arrests that had been conducted over a few years in the Rochester area, 84% were categorized as people having a medium or black complexion. And across the country, this is an issue, where local and state governments are issuing anti-immigrant ordinances, they're being deputized to enforce federal immigration laws, They're passing anti-solicitation ordinances, which are really targeted at day laborers so that they can't find work, and they're passing English-only ordinances. Even the basic constitutional right of a right to an education for undocumented children is being targeted all over the country. So what does this all mean? Bias-based profiling is the opposite of good police work, where actions are based on hard facts and not stereotypes. It is undisciplined policing. And profiling is simply wrong and does not work because of the personal and social costs it inflicts on entire people. Victims of profiling feel humiliated, depressed, helpless, and angry. Profiling reinforces perceptions by residents of the community that they are under suspicion and that they don't belong in this neighborhood. Individuals begin to change their behavior. They begin to avoid places completely. And they don't come in contact with government, looking at government as the enemy, including when they see crime happening before them. And in the past, when the government has engaged in widespread profiling, we often regret it later on, once the crisis, quote unquote, subsides. And this is particularly in the context of national security. So for example, the ACLU was founded right after the Palmer raids. The Palmer raids were raids that were conducted by Attorney General A. Mitchell Palmer in 1919 after a series of terrorist attacks in the United States, including the bombing of Attorney General Palmer's home, that were attributed to left-wing anarchists and socialists. How did the Attorney General respond? He responded by rounding up more than 10,000 suspected communists and anarchists, most of whom were Eastern European, Jews, Italians, Russians. Palmer found no evidence of a proposed revolution, but a large number of these suspects were held without trial for a long time and deported, the most famous of whom was Emma Goldman. And the vast majority were eventually released, but 248 were deported back to Russia, or to Russia. The most infamous example of widespread profiling by the government is one that's also not too far long ago in our history, and that is the internment of Japanese Americans during World War II. People, I think we quickly forget this period in our history, but the United States government during World War II interned more than 110,000 Japanese American citizens. These were United States citizens who were put in internment camps 70 days after the attack on Pearl Harbor. And what's most frustrating when you study this period in history is that public sentiment at the time was strongly in support of this policy. There was overwhelming public sentiment and fear against of another Japanese invasion or attack against the United States. And some public officials at the time even talked about how the Japanese citizens or United States citizens of Japanese descent needed to be placed in internment camps for their own protection because they were worried about how the public would treat them. And we're hearing the same arguments today, not in this severity, but the core arguments are still very similar against Muslim Americans. And I only need to remind you about the Park 51 controversy about a year and a half ago, when there was an outcry over the fact that Muslim Americans wanted to build a mosque a couple of blocks from the World Trade Center. But the problem is, in the post-9/11 era, government and law enforcement are utilizing the profiling tactic again. So I want to read a quote from Justice Brennan, who in 1987 delivered a speech at Hebrew University in Jerusalem. And by the way, in case you don't realize, my name is Israeli. I was born in Israel. So the issue of the conflict or false conflict between national security and civil liberties is one that I and my family have dealt with for many years, long before 9/11. And Justice Brennan delivered a speech in 1987 at Hebrew University in Jerusalem on this very topic. And here's what he said. A jurisprudence that is capable of sustaining the supremacy of civil liberties over exaggerated claims of national security only in times of peace is, of course, useless at the moment the civil liberties are most in danger. We are in one of these moments right now when there is a conflict or purported conflict between civil liberties and national security. We are in this moment right now when in too many parts of our American life, civil liberties are being sacrificed in the name of national security. So I'll end with an uplifting note, since I wouldn't choose this topic unless there was a silver lining in the end. So the good news is that a movement is building to respond to this attack on civil liberties in all three phases. In the attack on civil liberties in the immigration context, in the national security context, and in the street policing context. In the immigration context, you see a backlash against state legislation such as the one passed in Arizona and Alabama that really criminalizes immigrant communities. And this did not receive a lot of news. Actually, last week, the Obama administration signaled that they are going to move away from what's known as the 287G program, which deputizes local law enforcement agents to enforce federal immigration law. And that's a very positive move. In the national security context, we've seen a backlash, although not as much as we should see, against the surveillance of Muslim Americans by the NYPD. There have been rallies, there have been protests, and there's a movement building against these practices. And in the stop and frisk context, which to me is one of the most shameful marks on New York City right now, hopefully a movement is building, and we're working really, really hard to build that movement. We hope that in the next few weeks and months, all of you here in the room will read about a movement that will be covered in the local papers and your television channels that is building in New York City. Because I will tell you this, when you meet with people who live in the communities that are most impacted by stop and frisk practices, this is very much a part of their life. There is a ritual that's developed in the communities that are most impacted, which are neighborhoods like Crown Heights, the South Bronx, East New York, Bushwick, where when a boy turns the age of maybe 11 or 12 or 13, a conversation happens. And the conversation is between the mother and the child, or the father and the child, and it goes something like this. Son, you need to be prepared that you're going to be stopped several times over the next few years by police officers. They're going to go into your pockets, they're going to go into your wallet, they're going to go into your bag. And even if you know that this is completely unjust and that you did absolutely nothing wrong, you need to stay quiet. And you cannot fight at that moment against this. Because you know what? They're carrying guns and you're not. And you need to be careful and to protect your own life. That is what's happening in communities of color, in low-income neighborhoods in New York City. We at the New York Civil Liberties Union, working with our allies, are trying to elevate this and educate all New Yorkers about this really tale of two cities right now in New York City and tales of two New York City police departments. We are building a movement. And a key component of this movement is going to be to pass legislation both on the federal level and the local level that's called the End Racial Profiling Act of 2012 that will fix many of these problems. And we hope that you will support us in our work and that we will continue to talk about this in days, months, and years to come. Thank you.